Okay, good morning everybody and welcome back. We are going to start the second session of the day. We have three speakers in this session, Armagan Koser, Michael Meyer and Mauro Chinappi. So the first speaker will be Armagan Koser from the University of Twente, and he will talk about mechanical understanding and reverse engineering of ion channel. Please, you can start.
Thank you very much, Alberto, and everyone, scientific and technical team, for making this inspiring meeting possible. I will talk about first the mechanosensitive channels. So when I moved to Netherlands, to Groningen, so this is a nice fort in the east part of Groningen that is in the border. I also start same time working with a mechanosensitive channel of large conductance. So they are beautifully looking alike. This is the pore region, and these are the helices forming with five identical subunits like this, and then the lipids are around. So what they do in this is a bacterial mechanosensitive channel, and their function is upon sudden hypoosmotic shock to open and release the osmolytes to balance to keep the self, to prevent cells from lysing. So they sense the mechanical force, the stretch in the membrane, when it becomes really not affordable anymore. So then they are the last resource to save the cell from lysing. So in general, what we are interested in my group is that we like to understand how ion channels are working. And I also enjoy playing with them to do some other stuff. So what we do, we have fundamental work. We can either study them in their own origin of organism, or we clone them in different hosts, isolate them, reconstitute into different platforms and look at their properties. And we change them also. These are the current channels we are working on. I started working on channels involved in cancer metastasis, but it's not for today. So this channel was very interesting. They are homopentameric, the mechanosensitive channel of large conductance. Five identical subunits form a pore here, hydrophobic one. They sense the mechanical forces in the membrane, and then also they are sensitive to the molecules inserted to leaflets of the lipid bilayer. And the problem in the field was that they can be closed, and after different going through different substates, they reach the open state. And the conformational change is huge. So here you see the top view of the pore region about 3 angstrom, and this it becomes 30 angstrom when it opens. And it was a very interesting channel that first of all, it converts mechanical force in the membrane directly to conformational changes. So if you want to study how channels sense the tension, it's a very good model. You don't need any other cellular components. And then all the scientists in the field, like Sergei Shukarev, Paul Blount, Eduardo Perozzo, they all already had contributed a lot to the field. And at the end, what we knew when we were working on that is that if you look from the side, the channel activate. So in the closed form, it's like this. This is the pore region. Blue represents the lipid bilayer. When there's a mechanical force applied to the membrane, the pore doesn't open first. So first there's a conformational change in the helices. And then after a little more pressure or mechanical force, then you can open the pore. So the main energy is spent on expanding the helices while the pore is closed. And this was a model channel to study mechanosensing, and other channels didn't have, so mechanosensitive channels don't have a fixed hotspot that sensed the mechanical force. The question was how they open. So how they sense the force to open if they don't have a hotspot shared by all mechanosensitive channels. So the problem is that for me was interesting to see this to understand this part, how they go from closed to expanded, closed version. And until then, experimentally, what we were all using was a patch clamp electrophysiology. So this is the cell, and these are the forces, mechanosensitive channel, MSCL. What you do is that you apply a suction and stretch the membrane, and with that you can force channel to open, and then you get a current signal as the channels open, and from their kinetics you can understand many things. But the problem is, in this case, if I like to study sensing the mechanical force, this is too late. The patch clamp is too late, because sensing part during that time, the pore is still closed, and with patch clamp you can measure the ions coming through the open channel. So then I thought, how can we study these channels? And as you heard a very nice talk this morning from Mark Sanson, that at that time they were writing the theoretical part, the hydrophobic gating. And we were seeing in MSCL field that when scientists, they change the amino acids in the pore region of MSCL with different amino acids, they observed that as soon as you have a charged amino acid in this hydrophobic part, MSCL is very similar to this shape, the pore part. They show that whenever you have a charged amino acid, the channel was opening without even you put the pressure. So then we thought, hey, is it also happening in MSCL? And of course, Shukarev already proposed that this is the case. And we wanted to explore with the experiments. And the idea was that can we control opening and closing of this channel by changing the hydrophobic gates or by playing with it. The idea is that if I want to work, if I want to understand the channel gating before opening the pore, I need a technique, mostly spectroscopic techniques, not the patch clamp. Then I need to be able to open the channel. That was the reason why we had to explore these techniques. This principle. So then the idea was, okay, can we mimic or control this hydrophobic gate principle that we can open and close the channel by giving some external signals mimicking the membrane tension? And for that, I collaborated with Ben Feringa, who got Nobel Prize a couple of years ago, and his best organic chemistry student. What we did is that idea is, can we design molecules like amino acids but smaller, introduce them specifically to the hydrophobic part of the channel, and then give a signal, for instance, light or change in environmental factors that will charge the this molecule and then open it. And indeed, we get many versions of these molecules, and this is one of them. So Martin, excellent chemist, he designed different molecules. This one is a light switchable version of a molecule that if you introduce it from this group into the hydrophobic pore of the channel by using a cysteine residue, and then when you illuminate these channels or this compound with UV light, then it becomes a zwitterionic molecule, and it theoretically should open the channel. And the idea was, can we also close it? So in that case, you just illuminate the compound with another wavelength, visible one, then it goes back to the neutral version, so you can open and close. So then to show that I was doing the patch clamp, and what I observed was very interesting. So you don't apply any voltage here. And this top one is the current, as you see in the C. These spikes are ionic current coming from the open channel. And what I was doing, keeping the pressure constant, but changing the light source from visible UV to UV, and then looking at what happens. And I always observed that as soon as you switch UV light, there was a delay, so about a minute or more, for the channels fully open. And what you see here, the tiny openings, they were not noise. So if you look at them in an expanded version, they were sub-open states. And whenever you go to visible light, so in B here, I expanded it, they were stopped, the channels stopped opening, so they were closing. And you switch to UV light, again, you have this gap and small openings, and then channel was fully opening. So then I thought, hey, is it so that, so this was not a random thing, so I observed a lot, almost every time. And then I thought, it could be that I always labeled all five subunits of this channel, but if I see a sub-open state, could that be because I maybe, when I apply UV light, not all five subunits, the labels in all five subunits are activated, maybe only one or two or three. So it takes maybe time to activate all five. So this brought me a very good grad. So, and then I tested this idea. So if this is correct, it means that we can now have a tool to control opening of the channel to different substates by manipulating individual substates. So you have a fine-tuned per subunit on hydrophobic gating, if you like. Of course, here the challenge was this is a homopentamer, and we were introducing these molecules by doing cysteine mutation on the pore. If you have a homopentamer, you have a single gene, and if you make a cysteine mutation, you will end up with five cysteines in the pore. How could you control number of charged molecules in the pore? So for that, I had the idea that, okay, let's trick the cells by giving the gene twice. And in one case, we give the full gene encoding a native subunit like this. And then the blue one, the second gene, should encode a cysteine in the hydrophobic region. And to fish them out later, we attach different tags at the end of the subunits. And Jan Peter, he spent about 2 years to isolate all these individual versions of the channel. So in one case, you have only one subunit out of five that can that we can attach a label for the hydrophobic region. It's a, and then you can go up to five of them. So after 2 years, we were able to isolate all individual channels with different number of chargeable subunits in just 3 steps. The painful part was that once we have the isolation, we only were using the one fraction to eliminate any contamination. So after seeing that, we had to test, okay, what I was thinking was correct or not. So we had each population, so we reconstitute them into liposomes and then patch them one by one. By so you see here, wild type, there is no cysteine in that one, so you cannot label it. The other one has only one cysteine, so you can attach only one chargeable group. So you will have in your hydrophobic gate only one charge. In the second version, you have 3 subunits of wild type, but 2 subunits of chargeable mutant. So this way we obtain all of them, reconstitute them into liposomes, and now we did the patch clamp. First we did with the pressure to see if they are still okay. And you see that the wild type is this one. So this is amount of pressure we apply, this is open probability. And as you see, as we add more and more cysteine, we were getting, it was getting harder to open the pore because they were getting even more hydrophobic. But then and when you had all five subunits having the cysteine in place of the original glycine, it was not even possible to open the channel. They were all breaking the patches. But then, okay, then we wanted to see, well, we have the channels, they all seem to be okay. Then we said, okay, can we activate them by adding a charge to their hydrophobic gate? So this is the wild type. There is no cysteine. And if I enlarge this part, you don't see any channel activation. And how we were bringing charge to the hydrophobic gate through cysteine is that we add antisense. So that is the commercially available, always positively charged cysteine selective compound that if you add into environment, it immediately binds to the cysteines. So when we have one cysteine, as you see, I got back those early open states as I was observing with the light switch. I was very happy. And then when you have two charge, then you have two charge in the pore, and you can get a bit higher substate, so you can open the channel a bit more. And this way, you could even open 5-16 version without applying any pressure. Here, everything was breaking. You apply so high pressure, you cannot open. But here, it was possible to open them without even applying pressure. And to make sure that we are not seeing something unusual, we also applied after this stage also pressure, and you see that they go back to the original full open states, except that they become kinetically more fast. So then this gave us a tool that we can play in a with a hydrophobic gate, one subunit at a time, so we can charge it as we like, which means that now we can observe their conformational changes. And for that, and before that, we also did for fun to see how big the pore is if you activate this hydrophobic gate only with one charge versus with all five charges. And for that, we used the dual color fluorescence burst assay. So what we did is we constitute the channel into liposomes, and then we labeled the lipid bilayer with a fluorophore. And then we encapsulated different size fluorescently labeled proteins. And then we had an ion beam like this. So you have two laser beams focused in the same area. And you look at the events of the liposomes going through this focal area. If the signal of the lipid bilayer and the cargo coincides, you know that cargo is still inside. So it was not released. And by doing this with different size cargo and activating the channel with a charge residue, that commercial one, we observed that, okay, if you activate the channel only with one subunit, so hydrophobic gate, only one charge is introduced, the molecules, dimensional molecules that can go through the channel were like this. So if we open the channel with five charges, then the dimensions became like this. So it also corresponds to you could allow insulin going through the channel. Okay, so then, the idea was, the overall thing was, we want to know how the channel goes from here to here. And how can we observe that? At that time, there was a group in Belgium, Frank Sabot and his PhD student Albert Konijnenberg. They had a system which was developed by Carol Robinson in Oxford that they were using a mass spectroscopy, but it is ion mobility native mass spectroscopy, that it was now possible to see membrane proteins, molecular weights, plus their shape in the mass spectrometry. And what they did is, you have a ion channel in a detergent droplet, and you put it nanospray to the vacuum of the instrument. And here you have electrodes, which are activating one after each other, which guides your detergent protein droplet into this direction. But in the meantime, we have a drift gas coming from the opposite direction, and like a wind, it just peels off the detergents out of the channel, and you end up with your native channel here. And on top of that, we were very excited. Can we see our individual cysteine-modified channels? And indeed, we had the hypothetical molecular weight, and we could see them with this technique. But even more exciting was that by using the technique, you could also look for how, if the molecule has the same mass-to-charge ratio, like our channels, but if it has different conformations, you could also detect them with this method, because the much wider conformation of the same mass to charge ratio molecule would come to the detector much later than the more compact shape. So here what you see is that same protein with three different conformation. So then we said, can we see our channel gating theoretically when we have charge in these 16 residues, when we activate the hydrophobic gate, we should see a big conformational change in their helical pairs. So for that, we apply this technique, and then we said, okay, let's start with the 516 version so that you can fully charge a hydrophobic gate. And what you see here is that the rotationally averaged cross area, cross-sectional area, which is the conformations simply. And if you look at the black one, so this curve shows the closed channel, what type of conformation it has. And you see that it has only one peak, so it has one conformation. And if you would go to 516, if you add MTZ, this charge molecule, then you would get this yellow version. So you have 1, 2, 3, 4 different conformations. It is very cool. And then the referee said, how do you know that you are not denaturing the protein? Then to prove that, we add DTT to remove this charge molecule. So you go back to the neutral hydrophobic version and you see you are back to the original closed version. So this shows that we can observe conformation changes of this channel by using the mass spectroscopy. And then we tried, and of course, all the rest of the molecules, if you open a little bit more. And then we could see in the different conformations when we add more and more charge to the hydrophobic gate. And so we were very excited, and we also complement this work with EPR spectroscopy and the electron microscopy. So what was interesting here is that in these experiments, we use the channel in detergent, so it's not anymore in lipid bilayer. And seeing these changes in detergent solution suggests that the channel, the gating is intrinsic to the channel itself. Of course, lipid-filet effect, but it doesn't prevent channel to work. I mean, if you don't have lipid, channel would still activate with hydrophobic gate. And to prove that, we did many experiments, but here you see that we could show instead of using liposomes in our EPR experiments, we use protein in detergent, and we could show that you could activate with MTZ. And the cryo electron microscopy work by Catherine also showed that the channels were in detergents, not in liposomes, and they were activated by MTZ. And what is overall area change that she observed was almost identical what we observed with mass spectroscopy. So it was quite exciting. Okay, so you can, we said that, okay, we can see large conformational changes in the global way. How about changes occurring in the individual level? Where this conformation change starts, at which part of the protein? Is it in the middle or top? To understand that, we said, let's make a new compound that could tell us the microenvironment of individual positions of this inner helix, which makes the biggest movements. So for that, Martin made an environment-sensitive probe that it would give different emission spectrum at different wavelengths, at different hydrophobicity of the environment. But the problem was that that label attaches to the protein through cysteine. And we were so far using hydrophobic gating to open the channel using cysteine attaching molecules. And this time we said, okay, now we need another trick to activate the channel in spectroscopic measurements. Then we explored how about looking at the protein-lipid interaction. And we know from Perozzo's work that when you introduce asymmetrically lysophosphatidylcholine to the one leaflet of the membrane, these mechanosensitive channels activate without you apply more tension. So they lysophosphatidylcholine mimics the tension in a way. But to prove that, we said, okay, let's take three mutants. So first wild type. So we isolate the protein, wild type channel, put into liposomes, put a self-quenching fluorescent dye, and then start titrating the system by adding lysophosphatidylcholine. And we look at the percent release. So what happens if channel opens, the calcium, the self-quenching dye goes out to the solution and it starts giving fluorescent signal. So by using this method, we looked at how much lysophosphatidylcholine you need per liposome to activate the channels. And we said, okay, if this is representing LPC detention, if we have a mutant that is known to open much with much less tension, should also require less LPC, like this blue one. Indeed, it was like that. And we also tried a mutant, which was known to activate much harder because it was a loss of function. And indeed, it required also more LPC to activate. So this was a way to show that now we can use this trick by titrating the membrane, we can activate the channel to different degrees. And another fun thing was that can we do this reversibly? And Martin saw that in biological systems, lysolipids are taken out of the membrane by albumin. And then to test that, we add the bovine serum albumin to our experiments to see if we can also revert this process. And indeed, so when you have the protein, start adding LPC, it starts, it activates the channel, but as soon as you add BSA, it stops. So then channel closes. You add LPC, you activate the channel, remove it, it stops, and you can do many steps. And we also showed that with EPR spectroscopy that we can reversibly activate the channel. But more exciting part was now, okay, so we can activate the channel in liposomes. So let's do the experiment. So what we did is that we mutated every position one by one in this most mobile helix that forms the pore. So we mutated every position to a cysteine individually. And then we label them with this with our label that will tell us if the environment is hydrophobic, it would emit in this wavelength. If it is very hydrophobic, it would emit in this wavelength. So we have a huge range. So Martin had to design this so that we had a larger spectrum. And with that, we did the experiments. So you see what you see is that this is the this transmembrane helix, with how hydrophobic or hydrophilic it is. And these are amino acid residues. This is what we observed as the emission wavelength normalized. So what you see is that the black line, the closed version of channel, every residue is already in a different microenvironment. And the number 29 is the most hydrophobic part around this region. And what happened is that when we add 250 micromolar LPS, what we saw that some parts of the channel, like here, already changed to a different environment. They are in a more hydrophilic region, whereas other residues like 41 didn't mind at all that amount of, so nothing is changing in their environment. And we keep titrating them, so you add a little more, and we saw that the pore region opens further, and some other parts are now activating like this one, 33. Before it was little in a different environment, now it's in a much different environment. So when you do this, we see that some parts are not moving. If you titrate the opening of channel, other parts activate very first and then they don't change afterwards. But of course, this is too difficult to interpret. And there's a lot more data in this than just what we are seeing here. So to understand more, we collaborated with a mathematician who is my brother. And now what we ask him to tell is that what is happening here, how the whole thing starts, if these are the experimental data. So we gave him, so we have 5 different conditions. These are titration of the liposomes with channel opening further and further, and 30 positions, and per data point, you have 3 independent experiments from expression to reconstitution and labeling as everything. And then what he assumed is that, okay, if you add this LPC, The helix starts changing conformation. This I show you one helix, the pore-forming helix, and these data shows the overall movement at the end. After we modify the channel, but we open the we add the LPC to activate the channel, and what we observe is not just that position of the channel, but overall activity. And then we also assume that not any amino acid will move alone in isolation. So they always interact with the one before, after, or maybe fully somewhere else. So by using these assumptions, what he did first defined who can activate, who can interact with whom and how much. To do that, so let's see only in four residues what is happening. So if we had only four amino acids and only one situation, we could have six different situations. So for instance, number 17 amino acid could interact with 18, 18 with 19, or they can interact in 3 or 4. And the next step was, how can we quantify this interaction? How to quantify this data? And he said that, so the assumption is each amino acid represents an axis in a space, and the space has as many dimensions as the total number of amino acids. For instance, in this case, you have four, like this. So you have four amino acids, and then in a four-dimensional space. So you will see what I mean in a minute. So what we did is like this. So we are only looking at four different residues and trying to see how can we quantify this value as a movement. So if you look at the sequence one, 17 and 18 residues, how they are related if you go from closed state to the first activated state. So what you do is that we have two amino acids, two axes, amino acid 17, amino acid 18, and these are the values that the experimental data what we get. And what we did is that if you look at number 17 and 18, in the first situation, number 17 was in 0.49, and number 18 was 0.47, so they meet here in this space. And the same two residues, when you move to 250 millimolar LPC, so first activated state, they move to here. So then we said, can we then define the movement as the angle between these two vectors? In that case, it could be that these two residue together, the difference in their conformation change could be defined by two vectors with this much angle in between them. And when you do this for all residues, in this particular four amino acid case, you could define how much change occurs when the amino acids are moving together. And then if you apply this to visualize that, what we did is that, okay, let's draw here the amino acids, and here are the angles. The lines are showing who is interacting with whom at that moment. So if 18 and 19 residues move together, we show it with a line, and the amount of change in one condition was something like 0.something here. And for the sequence six shows that all four amino acids were involved in a movement, then the angle was about 4.something. And finally, to say, okay, how do we summarize this result? To say what happened to number 17 position, we just average all lines involves this amino acid residue. So like this, so we call it as motion line. So number 17 is here, and the average movement of that, average of these angles is like this. And if you look at number 18, it would be like this. And when you do the same thing to whole, now you have 30 amino acids, four different conditions. So this is from zero to first open condition, from first to second, second to third, third to fourth. So this is fully open. And you see that it's not a random thing. So they different amino acids interact with each other and make different movements. Of course, to use this data in a more reasonable way, what we did is that we expressed them with polynomials. And from there, we said, okay, now we already observe in our experimental data that in our experimental condition, we were using 250 micromolar LPC to open the channel. And with this model, we saw that, okay, average movements are like this per amino acid residue. And when you add more and more, you get more movement. But you see that there was already a big movement when we achieve with the smallest amount of activator. So we said, if you use this mathematical model, can we predict what could have happened between time zero, so no activator, to any other concentration of activator that experimentally we are not comfortable to measure because it's in the more in the error range. And then he could do this, so he could use this data to predict how could you come here from the beginning. And then he asked us to test a couple of concentrations, and he was expecting that he was predicting these red dots per residue for that concentration of activator, and the blue dots were our experimental results. So we were well in the range of error in his measurements. So by doing that, by using the prediction program, what we saw is the following. So if you don't do prediction, just use the experimental results, you add 250 micromolar LPS to open the channel. And this is a heat map showing the darker is the most mobile and lighter is the less mobile. So what you see is that experimentally, we are already seeing more open channel. You activate it further, and then so first regions around here activated, it seems, and then amino acid residues above the pore are now more mobile if you activate channel further. And the third situation, you activate even more, then the bottom part opens more, and finally the top part also changes. But by using prediction program, we look from this was 250 micromolar LPS, so it's that amount of a certain magnitude of pressure. But here between zero and much less LPC, which we cannot experiment, and it shows if you at the very beginning of the whole this tension sensing, the position 47, you see, and 17, 18. So these are the very first residues seem to be responding to the tension in the membrane. And they are also not random in that they are in the interface of lipid water, and they are supposed to be in the most highest pressure in the membrane. So this is not published yet, so I will show we are writing that one. And so with that grant from the first observation until the last, what we achieve is that we were able to play with the hydrophobic gating to open the channel into different sub-open states. And then we could prove that this gating really occurs in MSCL as well. And then we could see conformational changes, global ones. And then we could detect where the whole movement is starting. I think I have 55, so maybe I will skip the rest, but just to mention that we had other reasons. So once we learn how to play with this channel, we also managed to engineer it to use in to use it for different purposes, like environmental sensitive drug release, like you release your cancer drug by putting the channel into the liposomes containing toxic drug, And when you give it to the body, they go to the tumor and they sense, because of the channels modifications, the environmental pH in tumor, and they release the drug over there. But I think I will skip all this because of the time. If you're interested, we can talk later. But I like to thank all the team behind the work and the support for the financials. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. Thank you for your very nice talk. Let's see if there are questions from the audience. There is one from Alberto Giacomello, who asks, can you detect the hydration level of the hydrophobic gate during the gating process?
What we did actually with the MD simulations, our collaborator, they looked at water flow through the channel in different situations. So this is what we did. I didn't present it here. So we looked at how much water can go through if you have only one charge or two or three or five. And also we did, but that is a different purpose. We did different, that was a coarse grain simulation to look at the water flow. We also look at the conformation changes with flowatomic simulations. But the answer is the first part. So we only looked at the water flow and then, but didn't quantify or so that was the only thing we did to look at the hydrophobicity.
Thank you. I have also a curiosity. Do these mechanosensitive channels, are these channels selective?
Their opening is so big that they do not select. So, and they are not only for ions, but small peptides can go through. So that we tested all those small proteins, they all go through it. But you can make it selective if you play with the hydrophobic gate with only single charge, or you can introduce molecules to the pore that they will select. So you can engineer it to be selective.
Thank you. So I thank again the speaker.